All right, so behind me today, I want to show you something new, which is going to baffle you a little bit. Don't worry, it's not an astronomy chart. We are still kind of Christian in this church. Okay, but behind me is what is called the Christian liturgical calendar, okay? Now, I have it there right now because we're actually in a season of the church calendar in the traditional yearly worship cycle of Christians called Easter time. Will you even say Easter time? Or in older language, some places call it, I think especially Catholics call it Eastertide, okay? Yeah, I know, it's not something that we're very familiar with, but in the yearly cycle, this was, in the history of our church, the tradition and life of our faith, a very important calendar, okay? And so right now, what may surprise you is that we are actually still in Easter season. Eh? Wait, what? I just heard, huh? Okay, wasn't that last Sunday, Pastor? Well, yes, that was Easter Sunday, amen. But actually, Easter, according to church tradition, actually lasts a total of 8 weeks. It begins with what is known as the Easter Triduum, okay, which refers to Good Friday, the Saturday that Jesus was buried, and Easter Sunday when he rose again. And it lasts for 8 weeks and culminates on a day called Pentecost, which is the day the Holy Spirit fell on the early church when God's Spirit met with us human beings as a community, as a church, and began to empower us to be witnesses of Jesus, His values, His way of life, to be able to share salvation with the world. So this season, these 8 weeks are supposed to be a pretty beautiful time in the year and in the life of a church community. In fact, the Catholic Church will tell you this is supposed to be a time of joy and a time of celebration for 8 weeks. But of course, most of us contemporary Christians, we don't know much of these old traditions anymore. Unless you grew up Anglican like me. But if you're a contemporary Christian, really other than Christmas and Easter, maybe sometimes we mention Pentecost because, you know, we like tongues and supernatural and all that kind of jazz, right? But why do I bring this up today? And well, partly the reason is because in the last 1.5 years, it's sort of been kind of weird. You and me, our lives has lost the regular seasons, rhythms and events, beginnings, endings and punctuations. And our time has become this big, strange, everything is the same, nothing. The repeated cycles that normally help us to process and live forwards have become jumbled. Now, I'm sure all of you here, you guys are hardworking, driven people, amen? We've all been working, moving, making the best of our decisions, making the best of things. But even the most driven of us here, we're sort of feeling like we're in suspension. Like we're sort of floating through life and time is just doing its thing irregardless of how we feel. So it's funny, right? This pandemic is an extraordinary time. People like to say that, right, in human history. But it also actually really feels like we're stuck in too much ordinary. So did you know, right, that the Christian calendar actually has 2 seasons in the yearly cycle called ordinary time? So there's a short one that occurs just after Christmas. Do we have it? There's a short one that occurs just after Christmas that lasts for 6 weeks, which happens to coincide every year for our church with the time that our leadership team does planning and reading each year. And then another huge one straight after Easter and Pentecost that lasts almost 6 months. Which incidentally is also when TiVo usually does our training and development season. So you see, I don't think it's a coincidence, right? There is something inbuilt and cognitive in us human beings that certain events, certain moments of celebration, certain conclusions like Christmas and New Year's Eve naturally ebb into a time of evaluation and setting goals. There are certain times of work and intensity like Easter season or I don't know, your church or your company audit season, it flows into longer seasons of personal development and steady grind. You see, you and me were supposed to oscillate between extraordinary seasons into ordinary time and then come back around again. And that is where part of our progress, our productivity and momentum as human beings comes from. You see, there's a part of human existence where our drive and our acceleration comes from life being lived in cycles. That those rhythms are part of, you know, those of you, let me plug my sermon, The Good Life, right? Those rhythms are part of your life feeling as it should. Amen? So for the next couple of weeks, 7, 8, 9 weeks, I'm going to be preaching some messages that are somewhat inspired by the Christian liturgical calendar. Is that all right? And what I want to do is try to bring us back to some sort of focus this year. Whether it's myself or your leaders on the platform or in your CGs or in your ministries when they talk to you, we'll be sharing stuff that speaks to the values and the vision of our church. And the direction and the tempo that we're trying to re-engage with in TiVo. And really what I want to do is to bring back some momentum to your current rhythm of life. To your life and to the life of our church. And I want to see if whether together as a church we can shift ourselves one gear higher, shake off more of whatever is the inertia that you may be feeling in your life, and start to accelerate things a little this year. So I really want you guys to track with me, okay? Is that all right this next few weeks? To listen out, to listen in, to spend time these 8 weeks praying and reflecting and asking God to help you align, to help you renew, to help you recalibrate. And let's focus on moving forward together as much as we possibly can. Because it may feel, guys, like it's an overextended ordinary time. Like you're stuck in a state of constant reflection and re-evaluation of your life. Trying to figure out your dreams and your goals. It might feel like it's this long season of mundane grind, the same day over and over again. But it's not. It's not supposed to be ordinary time. It's supposed to be Easter time. This period of 50 days is supposed to be significant in our spiritual lives. Jesus has just resurrected. The Holy Spirit is about to move. You know, for Catholics and Christians alike, Eastertide is supposed to be a time where we renew our faith, we come together in community, and we transform into witnesses for Jesus. So let's use these next 8 weeks well to begin to recalibrate our lives towards God. Is that all right? So come, let me pray before I start. Father, I just pray for our church that the next couple of weeks will be good weeks, God. That you begin to help us to cycle out of whatever funk we are in, whatever inertia we are in, whatever comfort we are in, God, in order to come closer to you and to walk with you into the future. God, I just ask also that you begin to bring our church together as one once again. God, we also begin to pray for all the churches, all the communities in Singapore, Christian or not Christian, God, we also pray that this will be a season of great leadership where people come together, where it's a chance to remake who we want to be and what we want to do and what sort of values we want to have as we try to bring people closer to God. So God, I just ask that your presence will be here, that your Holy Spirit will help us to make room in our lives for more of you and more of the vision of this church, God. We bless you. In the name of Jesus and all God's people say, amen. Okay, so the title of my message is, It's Not Ordinary Time. So the context today in the Bible is, it is Easter morning. Now, if you want to read the four Gospels of our Bible, each has their own version of the event, and the details sort of vary from Gospel to Gospel, but in general, the broad storyline is that on Easter morning, Mary, the mother of Christ, Mary Magdalene, the one who got 7 demons cast out of her, and another disciple whom we've never heard of before, Salome, go to visit Jesus' tomb and discover that Christ has resurrected. Jesus' body is gone, and an angel, or some say 2 angels, appears to them. They tell them, hey, what are you doing here? Jesus has resurrected. Quick, go tell the rest. Of course, the women do, but some believe them, some don't. But over the next couple of days and weeks, Jesus starts to appear and reveal himself to different people. So here's one of the accounts, Luke 24, 33, says, they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying to each other, the Lord really has risen. He has appeared to Simon. Then the two disciples described what had happened along the road as they were walking, how Jesus was made known to them as he broke bread with them. And while they were saying these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said, peace be with you. They were terrified and afraid. They thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, why are you startled? Why are doubts arising in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. It's really me. Touch and see, for a ghost doesn't have flesh and bones like you see I have. Jesus said to them, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was with you, that everything written about me in the law from Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened his mind, their minds, to understand the scriptures. He said to them, this is what is written, the Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and a change of heart and life for the forgiveness of sins must be preached in his name to all nations beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Look, I am sending to you what my father promised, but you are to stay in this city until you have been furnished with heavenly power. Whew. So, it's been a radical couple of days post-resurrection. And if you think believing the Gospels and all Jesus did, that he did healings and miracles, you know, was crazy when you read it, you know, hard to believe, imagine how these dudes felt post-resurrection. You know, imagine how we must feel now, 2,000 years later, reading about it in retrospect and not actually experiencing it. Did Jesus resurrect? Did he not? Can we believe what they wrote about in the Bible? And dang, have you ever thought about this? How on earth did he appear? And why is it sometimes they couldn't recognize him? Listen, I can't answer any of those questions today. But what I can say to you is that whatever the disciples were going through is an experience we will all revisit regularly in each of our faith journeys. The struggle to understand God, the struggle to believe that God exists, the struggle to believe that Jesus is the best way. Which brings me to my first point, right? These next 8 weeks, during the time of Easter, one of the things that we all should be making a priority in our lives is to, one, ask God for revelation. You see, you know, the interesting thing about the post-Easter passages in the Bible is, compared to the rest of all the Jesus accounts in all the Gospels, you know, this one chapter is actually really low action in sequence. Right, I mean, you think about it, if you read the Gospels, right, the rest of the Gospels from Jesus's birth to, I know, his prophecy, to his birth, to his ministry, there's so much anticipation and action going on. And then suddenly you get to post-crucifixion and everything becomes really pensive, anticlimactic. In fact, reflective. You know, I'm not sure I can call this particular chapter sad, because when you read it, it actually really seems like the disciples were so stunned by what had happened to Jesus on the cross that they had the wind knocked out of their sails and they didn't even have 100% time to process grieving or being sad. You know, I think what was on all their minds, you know, after, you know, the 3 years of following him around and seeing miracles and signs and wonders, you know, suddenly Jesus is dead and they're asking themselves, was all that he said or did true? I mean, it's weird, right? I mean, obviously they knew the miracles were true. I mean, they saw it with their own eyes, things that Jesus has done. He healed the sick, opened blind eyes, delivered people from demonic possession, resurrected the dead even. And obviously, Jesus' teachings were powerful. It had captivated their hearts and minds and culture and turned life as they knew it upside down. But now, was Jesus dead? You know, were some of what he said, those prophecies, things he said about himself, wrong? And therefore, if those are wrong, could all of it be wrong? And was all that we experienced just coincidence or fluke or a sudden freak of nature? You know, they may have lived in a different time and context, but their experience of human struggle and faith were not unlike our own. We all go through seasons of pressure, disappointment, uncertainty, doubt, where we can start to wonder. And you know, in moments like that, what I have found is human beings, we tend to, firstly, maybe play it safe with our lives. Or for Christians, we start to play it safe with our Christianity. You know, this post-Easter writing in Luke is only one chapter long. But I swear, the number of emo strolls and sad meals the disciples had together in just one chapter outrides every other scene in the whole gospel. Because, you know, in times of uncertainty, we tend to, as human beings, come to a standstill. We might move around, so they did a lot of walking. We might fidget with our lives, but internally we're actually paralyzed. You know, the other thing that the post-Easter writings also tell us is the disciples also started going back to their past. You see, while two of them were emo walking along the road one day, Luke tells us they run into Jesus. And again, don't ask me why, but Jesus hides his identity from them and just walks along the road with them. Again, don't ask me how. I have no idea. But as they are walking, Jesus in disguise asks them, "Hey guys, why are you so sad?" And they go, "Do you not know? Friend, have you been alive on planet Earth? Jesus, the great teacher, was just killed." And they start to tell Jesus in disguise all the great things he had done once upon a time. You know, it's like us, right? Man, remember when we could do this pre-pandemic? Remember how God could move in worship when he wasn't restricted by our masks? Remember how church was like last time? You know, we get so preoccupied with the Jesus that was that we can't see the Jesus that is present right now. And the thing about human beings is if we start recounting and reminiscing for the past long enough, we literally start to return to it. Because the next thing that some accounts tell us in the Gospels is that the disciples, particularly those whom Jesus had turned from fishermen into fishers of men, they started to transform themselves back. For 3 years, they had risen up, grown up, expanded into leaders of people. And now, they started to shrink back again. You see, there is no such thing as a prolonged standstill in human existence. Now, of course, it's good to pause and reflect. We love that in our church. Now, of course, you need to sometimes slow down so you can safely change course in your life. But staying still and stagnant for too long, staying and sitting in inertia in our lives for too long, you know what that causes? Atrophy. Now, what is atrophy? Let me give you the definition. Is that all right? Some of them that I found. Atrophy is a wasting away of the body or of an organ part from defective nutrition or nerve damage. So, for example, if you have a hand injury and you stop using it for too long, your muscles start to shrink. Are you here? You start to be unable to use it the way that you once could. Atrophy is also an arrested development or loss of a part or an organ incidental to normal development. It is degeneration or decline from disease, a decrease in size, a wasting away or diminution to wither or deteriorate. You see, there is no such thing as staying still in this world. What remains still, guys, for too long, beyond what is normal, always atrophies and eventually dies. And that is why In our lives, we all need cycles of revelation. We can't do without fresh revelation. We can't live without faith. We can't live without hope. Renewed faith and fresh hope. So in our Luke 4 passage, brief mention is made of a famous story. Is that okay? Now, Luke's version doesn't tell us who it is, but we all know it is Doubting Thomas. Because the other version tells us, I don't know, maybe Luke wanted to spare him face. Okay? And so Luke 24:39 says, Jesus said to them, "Look at my hands and my feet, it's really me. Touch me and see, for a ghost doesn't have flesh and bones like you see I have." So some of you will know the story goes, one of the 12 disciples was nicknamed Doubting Thomas because he was famous for saying post-resurrection, "I will not believe unless I see Jesus for myself and I touch his wounds for myself." Thomas, right, he gets such a bad rap, this guy, for being the doubter. But the truth is, if you read the passages, all of them were doubters. He was just the run his mouth off crazy enough one to admit it out loud. "I will not believe until you show me evidence." You know, Christians, especially contemporary Christians, we're so scared of our faithlessness. But you know what I found? I found the truth is when we dare to admit our faithlessness, that is when God can give us the revelation that we need. Because you gotta understand something about faith, right? Faith isn't something you and I can just drum up on our own. It's something that sometimes we've got to seek out and find. It's something sometimes that we've got to ask and plead for God to give to us. You know, because faith isn't just positive thinking. It isn't some shallow self-help cycle yourself into hope. Faith is something when we talk about it in our Bible, it comes only when God opens our eyes to see Him and makes Himself present for us to touch and experience Him. You see, I may have a master's in theology, and I think that's important. Learning to think critically and genuinely and honestly about our faith is important. But can I tell you, there's a part of faith that for all the arguments and all the explanations that I can espouse and I can read, which I love, there is a part of faith that cannot be proven or explained in this life. It just is. And that part, that knowing, that assurance, that sureness, it comes solely from God Himself, from our encounters with Him, from Jesus stepping up to us, appearing to us, and allowing us to see and experience and touch Him. And when you have that encounter, that faith, that is when you and I begin to hope. Because the next thing Jesus says in verse 44 to them, He says, "These are the words I spoke to you while I was still with you. Everything written about me in the law and prophets, from Moses to the Psalms, it must be fulfilled." Verse 45, then He opened their minds to understand the scriptures. You see, they were in a state of wondering if what they once believed was true. And Jesus came, renewed their hope that yes, it's true. And yes, the future will come. And He also opened their minds to understand the scriptures in a deeper way because they had understood the scriptures before. They already had moments where their mind got blown. But now, I don't know, Jesus is something deeper. Jesus helped them understand those same words and those scriptures more. You see, you and I, friend, need revelation in order to live. We need it in order to live forwards in faith and in hope. So this season, however you are feeling about life and about your relationship with God, listen, ask for revelation. Seek God and ask Him to reveal Himself to you. Next point. Number two, value true community. You see, everything in the church community, you know, everything that is or will be boils down to the quality of our relationships. Whether it's the richness of the presence of God when we come together to worship on Sunday or in CG, or the depth and color and life of who we are as a church, the impact that we make on each other and the world around us. Listen, the health of our relationships is what determines our ability to live out Jesus' ideals for humanity. And listen, for us to break free of this bad ordinary that has its hands on us, we need to come together. You see, the greatest cure to a bad inertia is great community. A community that comes together and dedicates itself to moving forward together. You see, alone it's always a hard swim upstream. But together, there is power to overcome. So let me bring in another idea that I want to pitch to you. Is that all right? Nowadays, I find too much is made about personal salvation and private relationship with God. But do you know this whole idea of personal salvation and private relationship with God? Do you know that it's a contemporary church culture? You know, we may have grown up with it, but it's contemporary. At one time in history, it wasn't even a thing. It actually only became a thing because churches had become institutions and organizations and hierarchy to the point where people were just too reliant on their leaders. So people, Christians, went through the motions and did what they were told. At one point in history, you know, it was so bad, the Bible wasn't even available in people's languages. So only the priests could read it. And you could actually go to a service and hardly understand what was going on because it was all in Latin, whatever country you came from. And it led to huge abuses of power. And so over time, personal salvation as a culture became a response to the lack of a personal relationship with God. But I have to push back and say nowadays, personal salvation has become so personal, we forget that Christianity is a relational faith. That coming together as a community to worship was central to the Sabbath. We forget that at the heart of the Ten Commandments is a relationship with God and a relationship with people. Yeah. We forget or we gloss over the real power of what Jesus said when he said, if two or more are gathered in my name, I am there in their midst. Church is not supposed to run like an institution. Church is not just an organization. Church is not a community club. And it is certainly not customer service. Church is a relational community. It is in coming together that Jesus is in our midst. It is in breaking bread together, living life, sharing meals. Actually, it's very funny that in post-Easter, revelation happens. Right? Luke 24, it tells us, Jesus was made known to them as they what broke bread together. That it was when the 11 and their companions, so it just wasn't just 11 people in the room, it was 11 and their companions, I don't know, their family, their friends, whatever, were gathered together, and that is when Jesus appeared to them. So listen, we got quite a few new people joining our church this season, right? Let's give them all a big round of applause. Woo! And I gotta say, you guys are some of the best new friends and new people in church I've ever met. I love it. You have a different spirit. You're just a different kind of people. But, you know, and why I say that is because a lot of times my experience of people joining our church is not always a good experience. Because, you know, a lot of times people think when we start a new church or community, why, everything is new. No, it's not true. We're just basically taking everything that's old and putting it into a mosaic together. Are you here with me? You see, because a lot of times we bring, whether we were from church or not church, we bring our pre-existing perceptions, our past experiences to the new communities that we join. Now, because there are too many versions of this to go through and too many scenarios, so I won't go through them. Except to say, church must never become reduced to an individualistic customer service type ecosystem. You know, I don't know how many times I've heard it said to me explicitly and implicitly, I'm looking for a church that meets my needs. In other words, sometimes people are saying, if you want my continued support, you need to meet my needs. Or sometimes we have people who come, I remember there's this one guy many years ago, don't worry. You know, I've been to so many churches, you know, they are good at this and you are good at that. This church is a 7.10 on this and you are 6 in that. And really when that happens, I go, so why did you leave that church? Right? And they'll tell me, oh, you know, I needed to find something more and I think I can find that here. And I go, okay, then why are you telling me to do it the way you came from? This is why we switched to Sunday, just for you. You see, human beings, right? We're really funny that way. We leave our old life behind because we want to move on from that old life. And then when we do move on, we want to go back to it. But here's the thing I want to say to all of us. Whether you're a first-gen Christian, whether you're a Christian that came from another church Christian, whether this is your first church Christian, you gotta understand, church isn't about you. It's not even about me. Yes, listen, God has made us, your leaders, responsible for feeding our sheep. But at some point, all of you have to become shepherds and feed others as well. So church isn't quite something you should shop around for, date, or swipe right on. Or left. Right, because it's supposed to be a place where we come together in relationship. All our differences, all our diversity, sometimes our flaws, of course, within the reason of character and ethics, right? And we break bread together. We aspire to do great things together. Now, of course, some things about church, every church is different. Some things are customizable, but some things are not. Because church isn't meant to be consumed. It's meant to be a coming together of vision, relationship, and mission. So this season, as we enter into Easter, I want us all to think and reflect about what community truly is. And how each of us is coming to the table relationally. And if, you know, and if anyone comes to the conclusion that this community and the way in which we do life in God is not for you, that's okay. Go find your tribe. But just make sure it's not because it's not the right fit, but not because you're coming to this community with the wrong values and perspectives about relationships. Because let me tell you, I found if the problem is you, no church will ever be your problem. And you will be missing out on the power of what Christianity teaches about coming together. And the different sort of life that God can give beyond what is private and what is personal. Because God gives each of us personal revelation, but He also gives certain things only in community. So learn to value true community. Because it is a wonderful thing. It's hard work. Because what we're talking about here is more than just fun and chemistry. It's more than coming to a great self-help talk every Sunday. It's something deeper. But maybe the most wonderful thing a person can have in their life. Finding number three, this Easter, make it your priority to live for service to the world. You see, Luke 24, 46 says, He said to them, this is what is written, the Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and for what? A change of heart and life for the forgiveness of sins must be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Look, I am sending you what my Father has promised, but you are to stay in the city until you have been furnished with heavenly power. Listen, if you don't desire or ever want to desire to be of service to others in the world, you're not going to do very well in this community. You're probably always going to feel pressured in our place. You're probably always going to feel that here your needs are not getting met enough. Because yes, we'll feed you, yes, we'll clothe you, yes, we'll encourage you and believe in your dreams, be there for you when you are down, and let me tell you, we'll be loyal to you even in your mistakes. Yeah. But this is a worshiping community. Yeah. This is a community of gratitude and service. We expect that the love you receive from God and from us must translate into service to others and to the world around you. You see, guys, what I believe of salvation has really changed over the years. You see, for myself, I no longer believe, or rather, well, I don't think I ever did, but I didn't know any other way than what I was taught. You see, I don't believe the goal of church is this reductive, personal, private salvation. Say the ABCs of accepting Jesus, and then you get free access to grace and blessings and a comfortable life forevermore. I don't believe that the most important goal of a church is to fill that seat every Sunday. Quite frankly, I couldn't care less anymore. Well, a little bit. But I don't care, because people who truly love God, who truly encountered Jesus, they figure those things out on their own. They don't need me to preach about it. You don't need to go to seminary or Bible study class to tell you how to be faithful and respectful of God. You see, my concern nowadays is, are the people that come to our community that God has called me to pastor, are you truly becoming more like Jesus? Are you becoming love and goodness and serving others around you and the world around you? You know, quite frankly, and I'm going to push this a little bit, mess with your mind a little bit, is that okay? Quite frankly, how you get there to love and goodness is less important than how you got there. Are you here with me? Yeah. Like, whether you got there because of Jesus or because of someone else who showed you Jesus without telling you it's Jesus doesn't really matter as much. Now, of course, I think conservative evangelicals will say I have a secular humanist ethic about my Christianity. But I will argue Jesus is about all of humanity, not just Christians. So I actually think God doesn't care as much about certain things as much as we do on the priority list. Whether we meet on a Saturday or a Sunday, whether you said all the ABCs of the sinner's prayer during altar call, the leader missed out one. Whether you speak in tongues all the time, sometimes, or are not comfortable with it, the question is, are our hearts and the way we live, are they being transformed? Because that's the reason, right? He said to them, this is what is written. Christ will suffer and rise from the dead. And a change, and what for a change of heart and life for the forgiveness of sins. And this must be preached in his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You see, that is the evidence of the resurrection, change of heart and life. Not just for yourself, but for all. So some people might call me a secular humanist, but I actually think that is part of our gospel. But for sake of all the conservatives listening in, just to make it a little bit easier on your language and framework, let me be very clear. I still believe knowing Jesus is the best way to bring salvation to the world. Yeah. To have someone, a God, a person whom we know and relate to and can be close to, God's goodness and love will rub off when we are intimate with Him. Yeah. Being with Jesus changes our soul. Yeah. So don't worry, I still believe in Jesus. I still identify as a Christian. But you see, that is what we work towards during Easter time. That is the change that we're aiming for when we work our way to the day of Pentecost. That we come to a point where our hearts are open and our lives are being transformed, that we get the added touch from heaven and God's Spirit being in love, it being in us, His Spirit of love and goodness and truth. If He is in us, if He has transformed us, then our words and our actions in this world and this life, they are good and they keep getting better. So Easter begins with Jesus' sacrifice and resurrection. But as our faith gets transformed, as our community comes together, it culminates in Pentecost. In God turning us into His witnesses. So He says that you are the witnesses of these things. Stay here until you've received heavenly power. So Easter is a time of revelation, it's a time of coming together, but for what? To become witnesses of Jesus to the world. Now, whether that be bringing others into the Jesus way through them receiving Christ for themselves, or by you impacting the world with your words and deeds the way Jesus did for a lot of His life and ministry. And let me tell you another fun, interesting tidbit. Do you know that the word for witness is actually the same word used for martyr? So what is it to be a witness for Jesus? Guess what? Being a witness for Jesus is about showing people how to live like Jesus in the way of His servanthood and His sacrifice. So, getting the Holy Spirit is not just so you can speak in tongues. It's not just so you can have some cool spiritual gifts to show off to other Christians. You know, that moment of the Holy Spirit falling on the day of Pentecost is about being transformed and empowered by God, both as an individual and as a community. For what? Listen, it's not to get rich. It's not to have a comfortable life. It's not empowerment to get married and have two kids, grandchildren, holidays, condo, and a car. I don't think anyone needs special supernatural power to be the traditional family unit. We've been doing it as humanity for thousands of years. No, God's power isn't for us to lead an ordinary life, but a life of servanthood and sacrifice for the betterment of humanity. And I believe the best way to do that for me is to lead as many people into a relationship with Jesus as possible. And to have this community move forward with God together in power. So still a pretty evangelical and Bible-believing person. Okay? So can I land? So 3 points today. Ask for revelation. Value true community. And can I just say, value this community that you have? And live for service to the world. That is true resurrection and life. And that is how we celebrate Easter time and what Jesus has done for us. So this afternoon, I want to spend time worshiping. Winnie's going to lead us in worship. I don't want to do too much leading. But what I want you to do is to re-engage with God for yourself as much as possible. I want you to learn and stir up your faith again. Whether that's praying in tongues or lifting your hands really high or singing really loud, reconnect with God in a way you haven't done for 1.5 years. So in a moment, we're going to sing the song, Make Room. And of course, I love the bridge of the song. I think we all love the bridge of the song. That whole idea of break down the walls of religion. But one of the other lines I love is actually in the verse, where it says, God, we're coming to you to lay down every burden and every crown, every lie and every doubt. You know, to me, there's something about that line that captures the struggle of our faith. We struggle because of the burdens we carry and the disappointments we face in life. But we also struggle because of the pride and ego we hang on to. And these things, sometimes they cause us to doubt, they cause us to lie to ourselves, and we start to miss out on what it truly means to be engaged with Jesus. So today, as you sing this song and as we worship, I want to encourage you guys, the next 6 months, the next 8 weeks, will you start to make room for God in your life again? Make room for His revelation, His understanding, His version of church and His version of community. You know, for His version of this particular church and the community you are committing your lives to, for the vision and mission of being love and goodness and in service to others and to the world. Otherwise, why be a Christian? There's no other reason to be a Christian. Can I just say that? Yeah, why come to church every Sunday? Why read the Bible? Why pray? What other reason is there? Make room for God in your life, for the true version of Christianity.